فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. We are in the explanation of the book مختصر في أصول العقائد الدينية written by العلامة عبد الرحمن بن ناصر السعدي رحمه الله. We finished the first أصل, and we're now inshallah ta'ala going to move on to the second أصل, the second foundation. نعم.
الأصل الثاني الإيمان بنبوة جميع الأنبياء عموما ونبوة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم خصوصا، وهذا الأصل مبناه على أن يعتقد ويؤمن بأن جميع الأنبياء قد اختصهم الله بوحيه وإرساله وجعلهم وسائط بينه وبين خلقه في تبليغ شرعه ودينه، وأن الله أيدهم بالبراهين الدالة على صدقهم وصحة ما جاءوا به، وأنهم أكمل الخلق علما وعملا وأصدقهم وأبرهم وأكملوهم أخلاقا وأعمالا، وأن الله خصهم بخصائص وفضائل لا يلحقهم فيها أحد، وأن الله برأهم من كل خلق رذيل، وأنهم معصومون فيما يبلغون عن الله تعالى، وأنه لا يستقر في خبرهم وتبليغهم إلا الحق والصواب، وأنه يجب الإيمان بهم وبكل ما أوتوه من الله ومحبتهم وتعظيمهم، وأن هذه الأمور ثابتة للنبي وأن هذه الأمور ثابتة لنبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم على أكمل الوجوه، وأنه يجب معرفة جميع ما جاء به من الشرع جملة وتفصيلا والإيمان بذلك والتزام طاعته في كل شيء بتصديق خبره وامتثال أمره واجتناب نهيه، ومن ذلك أنه خاتم النبيين.
خاتم أو خاتم؟
ومن ذلك أنه خاتم.
So it's both ways. You can say خاتم or you can say خاتم. Both ways. We will speak about that later, inshallah.
ومن ذلك أنه خاتم النبيين قد نسخت شريعته جميع الشرائع، وأن نبوته وشريعته باقية إلى قيام الساعة، فلا نبي بعده ولا شريعة غير شريعته في أصول الدين وفروعه، ويدخل في الإيمان بالرسل والإيمان بالكتب والإيمان بمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم يقتضي الإيمان بكل ما جاء به من الكتاب والسنة ألفاظها ومعانيها، فلا يتم الإيمان به إلا بذلك، وكل من كان أعظم علما بذلك وتصديقا واعترافا وعملا كان أكمل إيمانا. والإيمان بالملائكة والقدر داخل في هذا الأصل العظيم، ومن تمام الإيمان به أن يعلم أن ما جاء به حق لا يمكن أن يقوم دليل عقلي أو حسي على خلافه، كما لا يقوم دليل نقلي على خلافه، فالأمور العقلية أو الحسية النافعة تجد دلالة الكتاب والسنة مثبتة لها، حاثة على التعلم
حاثة على تعلمها
وعملها، وغير النافع من المذكورات ليس فيها ما ينفي وجودها، وإن كان الدليل الشرعي ينهى ويذم الأمور الضارة منها.
ضارة منها. ضارة منها.
ضارة منها. ويدخل في الإيمان بما جاء به الرسول بل وسائر
الرسول. إذن الرسول أو الرسول؟
الرسول.
نعم. بل؟
بل سوائر الرسل.
وسائر الرسل.
نعم. بل وسائر الرسل.
ده الشيخ رحمه الله العلامة عبد الرحمن ابن الناصر السعدي. He now moved on to the second أصل, the second foundation from the five foundations in which we are going to speak about, inshallah ta'ala. And he chaptered it by calling it Al-Iman, believing بنبوتي جميع الأنبياء, believing in the prophecy of all of the prophets, عموماً, all of them, generally. ونبوتي محمد خصوصا, and believing in Nabiullah Muhammad's prophecy specially. So all the previous prophets, we believe in their prophecy generally, overall. As for our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his prophecy, we believe it specifically, khususa. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, when he created the creation, as we know, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he didn't leave us to use our rationality and our intellect. But what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala did is, he placed a prophet for every nation. And every nation, that prophet, what he came to do was, it is to teach them and educate them about the prophecy, to educate them about worshipping Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, to tell them that which they need to know to please him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also to teach them that which Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala dislikes and does not love, to stay away from it. So the prophet's job is to tell the people what Allah loves and to tell them what Allah doesn't love, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and dislikes. So basically, the prophets, what they are is al-wasatatu. The prophets are intermediaries. But what type of intermediaries are they? They are intermediaries between the creation and the creator in at-tabligh, conveying the religion and conveying the message that they were entrusted with. But they are not intermediaries between the creator and the creation with shafa'a and naf'a. They're not intercessors in this world, or they are not naf'a, they don't benefit or harm the creation in this world. Okay? Because we know the word wasata, it takes place ala ma'anil iddah, many meanings it carries. Abu Taymiyyah, Abu al-Abbas, Ibn Taymiyyah al-Hafiz, rahimahullah, he expanded on that in a book which he wrote, which he called it Al-Wasitatu Bayna Allahi wa Khalqihi, the intermediaries between Allah and his creation. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, which is also published in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a, and it is also published separately. It's also published separately. So the author here is talking about وَسَائِطَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ خَلْقِهِ فِي تَبْلِيغِ شَرْعِهِ وَدِينِ. So the messengers and the prophets, their jobs is to convey to their creation the message which they were trusted with and that which they were given. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentions that أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَبَارَكُ وَتَعَالَى, he supports and he aids the prophets. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ أَيَّدَهُمْ بِالْبَرَاهِينَ الدَّالَّةِ عَلَى صِدْقِهِمْ. That Allah تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى, he aids the prophets with proofs that show that they are truthful. The prophets are supported. Once they are sent to the nations and their people, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala aids them and supports them. In what? بالبراهين الدالة على صدقهم. Things that prove that they are truthful and they are not lying. وصحة ما جاءوا به. And what they have come with is truthful and it's not a lie. وأنهم أكمل الخلق علما وعملا. And that they are the most knowledgeable and they are the best in implementation from all of the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَصْدَقُهُمْ وَأَبَرُّهُمْ. And that they are the most truthful ones and the most obedient ones. وَأَكْمَلُهُمْ أَخْلَاقًا وَأَعْمَالًا. And that they are the completest in terms of etiquettes and manners, and they are also the completest in terms of actions. So basically what the Shaykh is talking about here is the issue that many people call al-mu'jizat, miracles. That usage of the word al-mu'jiza is a lafdun ajnabiyyah. It's a foreign word. It's a foreign word from what? Anil kitabi wa sunnah. The kitab and the sunnah don't use that word. And the usage of this word al-mu'jiza was first introduced by the Mu'tazila, a deviated group that deviated from the path of Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. And what they say that al-mu'jiza is that it is anything that is outside the norms, khariqul 'ada. And they have a long explanation and a long discussion regarding it. But the word that you would find the Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah use instead of the word al-mu'jiza is they use dala'ilun nubuwah, evidences for the Prophet's prophecy, alayhi salatu wasalam. And there are scholars that write books on this. Al-Imam Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahani wrote a book called Dala'ilun Nubuwah. Abu Bakr al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah, he wrote a book called Dala'il al-Nubuwah. Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Firyabi wrote a book called Dala'ilun Nubuwah. So Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah previously and before, they used to use the word Dala'ilun Nubuwah and they wouldn't use the word Al-Mu'jizat. Dala'ilun Nubuwah means what? According to Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah is Al-Ayatul Azimah, the great signs, Al-Dalatu ala Sidqi al-Anbiya'i, that show that the Prophets are truthful in that which they state and that which they do. So that is what Dala'ilun Nubuwah means. That is what Dala'ilun Nubuwah is. Then the author rahimahullah, he goes on to saying that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala specified them. Wa anna Allah khassahum bi khasa'isa wa fada'ila. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he specified them with what? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala specified them virtues. Virtues la yalhaquhum fiha ahadun, that no one would ever reach. Wa anna Allah barra'ahum min kulli khuluqin radheem. Every bad etiquette and every bad manners there is, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he purified them from it. That's not present in them. They don't have that in them. They are protected from any deficiencies that a person can criticize their honor and their dignity with. Wa annahum, and that they are. Na'am, faddal Sa'ad. Wa annahum ma'asumuna.
وأنهم معصومون فيما يبلغون عن الله تعالى وأنه لا يستقر في خبرهم وتبليغهم إلا الحق والصواب.
So the Sheikh says أنهم معصومون, that they are معصومون. This word العصمة is أجنبي, it's a foreign word. عن الكتاب والسنة, in the كتاب and the سنة, بهذا المعنى, based on the meaning that the author is trying to use. This usage in this particular meaning is ajnabiyun an al-kitab wa sunnah. It's a foreigner from the kitab and the sunnah. You won't find it in the kitab and the sunnah. But you would find the linguistic meaning in the Quran. You will find that, which Allah used in Surah Al-Ma'idah, ayah 67, where Allah says, Wallahu ya'asimuka minan nasi. And what the word Wallahu ya'asimuka means is Allahu yahfaduka, that Allah will protect you من السوء الذي يريد الناس أن يلحقوه بك. That Allah تبارك وتعالى will protect you from the harm in which the people want to put you through. So the word that's used here, والله يعصمك, is actually meant by the linguistic meaning, the معنى اللغوي, which is والله يحفظك. Allah تبارك وتعالى is going to protect you, سبحانه وتعالى. As for the meaning that this author here means, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from falling short and coming with mistakes, which is the usma, falling short from mistakes and whatnot. This usage, you won't find it in the Quran, nor would you find it in the Sunnah, nor would you find it fi urf al-Sahaba. The Sahaba's usage, and the Tabi'een, and the Tabi'ut Tabi'een. But what they used to use is As-Sadiq al-Masduq. They would say As-Sadiq al-Masduq. They would use the word As-Sidq, truthful, alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's what you find in the Quran and the Sunnah. ولذلك Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah expanded on that, that you won't find this word Ya'asimu, the word Ma'asum. ma'soom. Ama ismah. You won't find this word fil kitabi wa sunnah in a particular meaning that is used by the mutaakhirin. Ibn Taymiyyah expanded on it in his good book, his kitab, which is very beneficial, An-Nubuwat, 2-volume book, An-Nubuwat. Naam. So sorry, annahum ma'sumuna, that they are truthful, fi ma yuballighuna, in the things which they convey, anillahi ta'ala, from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, wa annahu la yastaqirru fi khabarihim, and that it is not present in that which they convey, the information which they convey, wa tablighim illa al-haq wa al-sawab. There's only truth and haq in it. There's only correct and truth in it. They are truthful in everything which they say to us, the prophets. Naam.
Wa annahu yajibu al-imanu bihim wa bi kulli ma utuhu min Allah.
So here, yajibu ala al-abd, it is obligatory on the slave to believe in them. Al-imanu bihim, to believe in them. وَبِكُلِّ مَا أُوتُوهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ, and everything which has been given to them from Allah تبارك وتعالى. نعم.
وَمَحَبَّتُهُمْ وَتَعْظِيمُهُمْ وَأَنَّ هَذِهِ الْأُمُورَ ثَابِتَةٌ لِنَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَىٰ أَكْمَلِ الْوُجُوهِ.
So you love them. مَحَبَّتُهُمْ, you love the prophets. وَتَعْظِيمُهُمْ, and you honor the prophets. Pay attention here. And this is important. Jinsu mahabbati Allah. The love that you have for Allah is not the same love you have for the prophets. Ta'zeemu Allah, honoring Allah, is not the same honoring as the messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. So what we need to know, and many people mix up, is jinsu mahabbati Allah, the love of Allah with the love of the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Are you there? Each and every one of them is different. Huh? For example, honoring the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some people have misunderstood it. They thought that honoring the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam means to take him out of ubudiyyah and to give him the rights of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, in which he is alone in. Giving Allah's rights to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam. And they think that they are honoring the Prophet alayhi salatu wasallam by doing that. Is that honoring him? La. No. We took the hadith narrated by Rabi' ibn binti Mu'awwid radiyallahu ta'ala anha, in which Imam Abu Dawud rahimahullah narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he say to the woman who was praising him alayhi salatu wasalam? He said, leave off this which you're saying, or this which you're speaking, when she said, inna fina nabiyun ya'lamu ma fi ghadin, there's amongst us a prophet that knows what's going to happen tomorrow. She took him out of his rights. That's not his rights, alayhi salatu wasalam. So then Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam said to her, say what you were saying before and leave off this which you're saying right now. Because no one knows tomorrow except Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Ilmul ghaib is only for Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet Allah says in the Quran, قُلْ لَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبَ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءِ. If I knew the unseen, if I knew the ghaib, مَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءِ, harm would not have touched me. So this is an ayah which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So honoring the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and loving him is not the same as the loving of, it's not the same jinns, it's not the same essence of love that you have for Allah and his messenger the same. Nor is the love that you have for your wife is the same love as you have for your mother. And the love you have for your children is not the same love you have for your wife. All of the love here is of different ajnas based on the person that you are dealing with. Na'am. Wa ta'zeemuhum, and the honoring which you do. You see? The honoring in which you honor a person is all based upon different. وَلِذَلِكَ تَعْظِيمُ اللَّهِ, the way you honor Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is not the same way you honor the messenger alayhi salatu wa salam. The way you honor the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what? عَبْدٌ فَلَا يُعْبَدْ وَنَبِيٌ فَلَا يُكَذَّبْ. That is تَعْظِيمُ اللَّهُ. If you want to honor the Prophet, this is what you do. عَبْدٌ فَلَا يُعْبَدْ. He's a prophet. So he's a slave, so you don't worship him. And also what? وَرَسُولٌ, and he's a messenger, فَلَا يُكَذَّبُ, you won't disbelieve in him. عليه الصلاة والسلام. That's honoring him. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامِ إِبْنَ عَبْدِ الْهَادِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, إِبْنَ عَبْدِ الْهَادِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ, in his book, صارم المنكي في الرد على السبكي. He speaks about this issue. You can find it there, and we've referenced it a couple of times. نعم. But the love that we have for the other prophets and the honoring that we have for the other prophets, the Prophet ﷺ has it what? على أكمل الوجوه, in the completest of ways. His one is better and greater. نعم.
وأنه يجب معرفة جميع ما جاء به من الشرع جملة وتفصيلا والإيمان بذلك والتزام طاعته في كل شيء بتصديق خبره وامتثال أمره واجتناب نهيه.
The Sheikh Na rahimahullah says أنه يجب, it is obligatory, معرفة to know جميع ما جاء, معرفة جميع ما جاء به من الشرع, that you have to know everything which he came with from the Sharia, جملة وتفصيلة, generally and specifically. والإيمان بذلك, and also believing in that. والتزام طاعتي, and you are in accordance, adhering to his obedience عليه الصلاة والسلام, في كل شيء, in everything, بتصديق خبره, in believing everything which he tells you عليه الصلاة والسلام, وامتثال أمره, and following his command عليه الصلاة والسلام, واجتناب نهيه, by staying away from that which he prohibited you from. So the Sheikh rahimahullah here is telling us, he's telling us something known as معرفة ما جاء به النبي, knowing that which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came with عليه الصلاة والسلام. And what we know is that which the Prophet ﷺ came with, knowing it is of two types. Knowing that which the Prophet came with is of two types. المعرفة الإجمالية, a comprehensive knowledge. And the second one, which is المعرفة التفصيلية, a specific, narrow down understanding and comprehension. As for the معرفة الإجمالية, it is the معرفة الإجمالية. The overall knowing is الإحاطة, to comprehend. بكليات الدين مما لا يصح دين العبد إلا به. The first one, which is المعرفة الإجمالية, is actually comprehending and understanding the comprehensive matters of the religion. Without it, you're going to be a sinner. Matters which are things which you have to know, which are, for example, which will be said to be معلوم من الدين بالضرورة, matters you need to know out of necessity. That portion of knowledge, فهذا قدر واجب, this amount is obligatory على كل أحد من المسلمين, every individual. لا يستثنى منه أحد, no one given an exception. And توحيد falls under this one. توحيد is the portion of what? It is الإحاطة بكليات الدين مما لا يصح الدين العبد إلا به. And that is where the poet said, Sheikh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi said, وبعد فالتوحيد علم ينبل على العلوم كلها ويفضل قد أوجب الرحمن منه قدرا لا يصح دين ليس يصح الدين حتى يدرى وبعد فالتوحيد علم ينبل على العلوم كلها ويفضل قد أوجب الرحمن منه قدرا ليس يصح الدين حتى يدرى. So وبعد, to proceed, فالتوحيد, that توحيد is علم ينبل, علم, knowledge which is virtuous, على العلوم, on all of sciences, it's greater than it, كلها ويفضل, it passes it and it surpasses, it is greater than it, قد أوجب الرحمن منه قدرا, Allah has made obligatory from it a portion. ليس يصح الدين حتى يدرى. A person's religion will not be correct unless he knows it. That's the part which is known as المعرفة الإجمالية. As for معرفة التفصيلية, then there is no way to define it because فلا حد لها. There's no limit for it. It is the intrinsic of the religion. And this, of course, differs from person to person. It differs from the person, from one person to another person. For example, there's a portion that's needed from the mufti. There's a portion needed from the qadi. There's a portion needed from the muallim. There's a portion needed from the da'i who's calling the people to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. All of this is in accordance to the individual. The ma'rifatu tafsiliya. So for example, the mufti has to know more than the qadi. The qadi needs to know more than the muallim. And the muallim needs to know more than this, etc. Sahih? Then the author, rahimahullah, He tells us from the things of believing in the Prophet ﷺ is what? أَنَّهُ خَاتَمُ النَّبِيِّينَ, that he's the final seal of prophets. And this word, وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ يُضْبَطُ بِالضَبْطَيْنِ. The way to pronounce it, or the way to utter it or articulate it, is to say خَاتَمُ. You can say that. Or you can say خَاتِمُ. For example, if you say خَاتِمُ بِكَسْرِ التَّاءِ, this is an ismu fa'il, and it means آخِرُ الْأَنْبِيَا, the final prophet. But if you say خَاتَم, then it becomes an ismu ala بِمَعْنَ الطَّابَعِ, the one who has been sealed with all the prophets. الَّذِي يُطْبَعُ بِهِ عَلَى الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. So the meaning is the same in the sense where he's the final prophet and there's no prophet after him. نعم.
ومن ذلك أنه خاتم النبيين قد نسخت شريعته جميع الشرائع وأن نبوته وشريعته باقية إلى قيام الساعة.
So the sharia of our Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, this sharia that we have today, قد نسخت شريعته جميع الشرائع, it has abrogated all of the religions previously. Allah تبارك وتعالى says in the Quran, وأنزلنا إليك, we have sent down on you Muhammad الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه ومهيمنا عليه. من الكتاب ومهيمنا عليه. Allah says in the ayah, وأنزلنا إليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه من الكتاب ومهيمنا عليه. ومهيمنا عليه meaning that the Quran has abrogated all the previous legislations and all the previous religions. It has abrogated it. So the only religion that Allah accepts, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ, the religion which Allah تبارك وتعالى accepts, that's only accepted to him, is this religion, دِينُ الْإِسْلَامِ. Every other religion has been abrogated. It's been abrogated as a religion. And this religion is the final and last religion of all of the religions there are out there. نعم.
فلا نبي بعده ولا شريعة غير شريعته في أصول الدين وفروعه.
So the Sheikh رحمه الله here, he says وأن نبوته وشريعته باقية إلى قيام الساعة. His legislations is going to carry on until the day of judgment. There's no ending to it. Until the hour comes, no one can claim that there's a prophet after him. As Allah said in the Quran, ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاه وخاتم النبيين. He's a final seal of prophets عليه الصلاة والسلام. And then there is no prophet after him. And the hadith صحيح البخاري, فلا نبي بعدي. There's no prophet. There is no prophet after me. فلا نبي بعدي. There is no prophet after me, as he said. So his legislation and also his prophecy is going to carry on until the day of judgment. And then the Ahmadis are not Muslimin, kuffar. They are disbelievers. They are what? Disbelievers. And they are not considered to be Muslims. Now, وَلَا شَرِيعَةَ, and there is no legislation, غَيْرَ شَرِيعَتِهِ, other than his legislation, فِي أُصُولِ الدِّينِ وَفُرُوعِ. You can't say, well, in the usul of the religion, the fundamentals of the religion, Islam is the only religion, I'll take that. But furu', sub-branches, nah. We can make up our own laws, our family issues, we can deal with it ourselves. As for the constitution, how the countries are run, we'll do that ourselves. You can't say that. And tawheed al-aqidah will be implemented. We'll say to you that this is batil, and this is wahyu shaytan, a revelation from shaytan. وَإِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ لَيُوحُونَ إِلَىٰ أَوْلِيَائِهِمْ. The shaytan sends revelation to his allies, right? And then this is a wahyu min al-shaytani to you, that he convinces you and tells you that there's a difference between أصول الدين and فروع الدين in terms of where you take it from. لا, Sharia Islam is what deals with أصول الدين وفروع الدين, the fundamentals of the religion and also the sub-branches of the religion. نعم. Some people, by ignorance, they think that the أصول of the deen is only عقيدة. وهذا ضلال وهذا جهل. نعم, عقيدة is أصول الدين, but it's not only. There are مسائل which are in عقيدة and they fall under فروع. And there are matters which are فقهيات, عمليات, and they fall under أصول الدين. They fall under أصول الدين. So when the scholars, they say usul al-deen and furu' al-deen, don't think that all the usul of the deen is aqidah and the furu' is fiqh. La, that's a khata, that's a mistake. So that has to be understood. The Shaykh then said, went on to say, وَيَدْخُلُ فِي الْإِيمَانِ بِالرُّسُلِ الْإِيمَانُ بِالْكُتُبِ. From believing in the prophets, what falls under that is believing in the books. So believing in the books actually is it falls under believing in the messengers. لماذا؟ لأن الكتب, because the books, تنزل على الأنبياء, it comes down on the prophets. والرسل. Pay attention to this. The books that we're reading from, the Quran, for example, that we have, who's the one who brought it to us? The messenger is the one who brought it to us. So if you believe in a book, but you don't believe in a messenger, it's a what? It's an oxymoron. It doesn't work. It's the naqidani la yajtabi'ani. It's two opposites. You can't take. So when you believe in the prophet, the messenger, or if you believe in the books, then you'd have to believe in that. You would have to believe in the messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Idan al-imanu bil kutubi, believing in the books is what? Tabi'u lil iman bil rusuli. Believing in the books is actually something that follows believing in the messengers. Because as we know, la yujadu kitabun, there is no book that we know of, bila rasuli, without a messenger. Are you there? You could find a messenger that doesn't have a book. You could find a messenger that has a book, but you can never find a book without a messenger. Naam. Then the author goes on to say,
فَالْإِيمَانُ بِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقْتَدِي الْإِيمَانَ بِكُلِّ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ وَالسُّنَّةِ أَلْفَاظِهَا وَمَعَانِهَا فَلَا يَتِمُّ الْإِيمَانُ بِهِ إِلَّا بِذَلِكَ.
The Sheikh here now goes on to another issue, which is believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does it entail? What does it mean? In believing in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yaqtadi, it entails, it means al-iman bi kulli ma ja'a bihi, believing in everything which he has come with. Min al-kitab, from the Quran, wa sunnati, and the sunnah. So as much as you believe the kitab, you have to believe in the sunnah. The Quraniyun, do they believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? La, they don't believe in the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. Because believing in the Prophet ﷺ entails believing in also what? The sunnah he came with, alayhi salatu wasalam. Al-fadiha, you believe in the wordings. Wa ma'aniha, and you believe in the meanings that are in it. فَلَا يَتِمُّ الْإِيمَانُ بِهِ إِلَّا بِذَلِكَ. Your iman will not be complete unless you believe the Quran and the sunnah, the wordings and the meanings. Your iman will not be complete. ولذلك Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That whatever the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam utters, and whatever he sallallahu alayhi wa says, it's a revelation from Allah. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, the Messenger does not speak from his own whims and desires. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Everything which he speaks is a what? It's a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلِذَلِكَ الْإِمَامُ الْحَافِظُ الْحَكَمِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ, he said, فَسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةِ لِصِحَّةِ الْمَرْوِيِّ عَنْ رَسُولِ لِيُعْلَمَ الْمَرْدُودُ مِنْ مَقْبُولِ لَا سِيَّمَا عِنْدَ التَّظَاهُرِ الْفِتَنِ وَلَبْسِ إِفْكِ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ بِالسُّنَنِ فَقَامَ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ الْأَئِمَّةِ بِنُصْرَةِ الدِّينِ وَنُصْحِ الْأُمَّةِ فميزوا صحيحها من مفترى حتى صفت نقية كما ترى. الإمام الحافظ الحكمي says that the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم is what? فَالسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ. It's a second revelation. The sunnah of the Messenger is a what? فَالسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ. عَلَيْهِمَا, both of them together, the sunnah and the Quran, both of them, قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ, they are referred to as a what? Revelation. وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ, the path to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is what? By the riwayah, revelation, by the narrations. Why? لِصِحَّةِ الْمَرْوِيَّ عَنْ رَسُولِ, to know was authentically transmitted from the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. لِيُعْلَمَ الْمَرْدُودُ مِنْ مَقْبُولِ, so we can know what's مَقْبُول, what's accepted and what's also rejected. لَا سِيَّمَا عِنْدَ التَّظَاهُرِ الْفِتَنِ, especially when the fitna spreads. You see, وَلَبْسِ إِفْكِ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ بِالسُّنَنِ, and those people who are lying and forging their statements are trying to throw in their narrations in there, You need to know these narrations and the chain of narration. فَقَامَ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ الْأَئِمَّةِ Scholars stood up for them. Why did they do it? The reason why they did it is because بِنُصْرَةِ الدِّينِ to give victory to this religion. وَنُصْحُ الْأُمَّةِ And they were sincere advisors in this. They criticized those people. They called them كَذَابُونَ Liars. And they gave them name. غِيبَة got permitted for this reason. Are you there? بِنُصْرَةِ الدِّينِ وَنُصْحُ الْأُمَّةِ فَمَيَّزُوا صَحِيحَهَا بِمُفْتَرَى حَتَّى صَفَتْ دَقِيَّةً كَمَا تَرَى So they distinguished the narration from one another, one from the other. Until it became what? حَتَّى صَفَتْ نَقِيَّةً Until it became naqi, clean, pure. كَمَا تَرَى As you can see it today. Ahmed comes, rahimahullah, كَذَّاب, he'll say. Al-Awza'i would refute him. Sufyan al-Thawri, Shu'bat ibn al-Hajjaj, Yahya ibn Ma'in, and the likes of them. They came, فَمَيَّزُوا صَحِيحَهَا بِمُفْتَرَى حَتَّى صَفَتْ نَقِيَّةً كَمَا تَرَى And you're enjoying their efforts today. And then when somebody criticizes a person you like, you say, why are people speaking about people? The religion is being protected like this. The religion is being protected. And it is being saved by, like this. لَسِيَّمَا عِنْدَ التَّظَاهُرُ الْفِتَنِ Especially when the fitna spreads in the land. لَسِيَّمَا عِنْدَ التَّظَاهُرُ الْفِتَنِ وَلَبْسِ إِفْكِ الْمُحَدِّثِينَ بِالسُّنَنِ And then you find these people who are lying about the religion. Contributing their own thoughts and minds into the deen and say whatever they want. فَقَامَ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ الْأَئِمَّةِ Scholars, they stood up for it. People of knowledge. And what did they do? They clarified one liar from the other one. And the person who's truthful and his narrations are correct. They went in details. They spent their lives on it. وَلِيَاكِ يَحْمِ الْمَعِي رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ He traveled to Abu Nu'aym Fadl ibn Dukayn رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ Just to see if he really is an imam and that his memory is sharp. Why would they cut that distance for? Just so that they make sure that the Prophet's narrations are protected. Rahimahullah. So Allah made people like that for it. Naam.
وَكُلُّ مَنْ كَانَ أَعْظَمَ عِلْمًا بِذَلِكَ وَتَصْدِيقًا وَاعْتِرَافًا وَعَمَلًا كَانَ أَكْمَلَ إِيمَانًا
Look at this. And everybody. كُلُّ مَنْ كَانَ أَعْظَمَ عِلْمًا Anyone whose knowledge is greater. He knows these masail. مَعْرِفَةُ الْإِجْمَالِيَّةِ Ma'rifatu tafsiliyah, and he's in the tafsiliyah, he goes into details more and he studies even more and he doesn't just say, oh, I'm just going to suffice myself with what? I'm only going to suffice myself with a tawheed and the minor things that I need to know. Rather, he goes in more details. The more a person is more knowledgeable than another person, wa tasdiqan, and he is more in belief of it, wa atirafan, and acknowledgement, wa amalan, and action, kana akmala iman, and his iman is more completed than yours. And what's the maqasid? What's the objectives of the sharia? What is it? One of the things that the sharia wants you to gain is complete your iman. One of the things that the sharia came to do is to make sure that you complete your iman and that you nurture your iman. Sahih? Then what you need to know is فَإِنَّ كَمَالُ الْإِيمَانِ لَا يُحَصِّلُهُ الْعَبْدِ If the sharia came to make sure that you establish tawheed and iman in your heart and to strengthen your iman, and you won't be able to, you will not be able to establish and complete your iman, وَلَوْ صَامَ نَهَارُ Even if you fast all day. وَقَامَ لَيْلُهُ And you stand up all night. The only way you're going to gain it is what? مَنْ كَانَ عَارِفًا بِمَا جَاءَ بِهِ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The one who knows what the Prophet came with, عليه الصلاة والسلام. مِنَ الدِّينِ مُصَدِّقًا لَهُ بِالْعَمَلِ In terms of religion, in terms of what? The one who knows it properly. There's a story I have to mention. Are you there? This story is a long story, but it is something لا شك ولا ريب is authentic. And I'm not generally a person who does tell stories. But this story is authentic and it's in the kitab written by Ibn Abi Shayba. He wrote it in his Musannaf. This is narrated by Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Abu Musa al-Ash'ari told this in a gathering just before he died when he was on his deathbed. He told the story of a man by the name of The story is known as Sahib al-Raghif, the man of the bread. Okay, this story goes something like this. And the story is that there was a rahib, a worshipper. This was from the previous nations. Back in those days, what the people would the rahib would do, the monk, is that he would go away and detach himself from the society and the community, and he would go away and he would go far, somewhere very very far. And pay attention to this because this is very powerful. when they leave, they will go to a soma'a. A soma'a is, it's like a hut. Are you there? It has two floors. You guys know the story of Ibn Jurayj, right? Ibn Jurayj. Ibn Jurayj is the one that the young kid spoke. The kid, young kid spoke the hadith in Sahihain, or Sahih al-Bukhari for sure, in which, it's a long story, but ala kulli hal, Ibn Jurayj, he would do this as well. Is that the soma'a has two floors. The upper floor doesn't have a staircase. The way to go up there is that there's a rope there. There's a what? There's a rope. So he would only throw that rope when he wants to come down. When he goes up, and he's on the second floor, he would take the rope up. The reason why he would take the rope up is because he doesn't want no one to come to him. That's how much they detached themselves and disconnected themselves from the people. This man for 70 years, this rahib, this monk, 70 years he was worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one day he came out of his soma'a and he came out to the market and he saw this beautiful woman. He saw what? He saw this beautiful woman. And when he saw this beautiful woman, his shahwa increased. And so he fell into ما يقع الرجل, that which a man would fall into with a woman, يعني زنا, and he stayed with her for 7 nights. And after 7 nights of spending with her, he cried. He remembered and he realized what he has just done. He realized what he had just done. The severity of what he just came with. So he did not take a step. إلا سجد لله, except he prostrated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He went to a place where there were fuqara, masakeen, poor people, 12 of them. There were 12 people who used to sit at a particular place, and he came and he sat with them, and became how much? It became 13 people. These 12 people who were there before him, there used to come a monk. A monk used to come before. And what he would do is, this monk would give each one a bread of these 12 poor people. So the monk came and he gave his 12 breads. But today there's an extra guest, right? There's a what? There's an extra guest. So this extra guest took one of the individual's bread. And this is the rahib. The rahib who fell, he took an extra bread. So the man went to the rahib, the one who was giving the bread out, and he said to him, "Where's my bread?" And he said, "I brought 12 breads, and I used to always bring 12 breads, and I've given you the 12 bread." So what he said to him was, "Well, I haven't received it." Then the rahib who took the bread, he heard the discussion between the poor man and the one that was giving the bread out, and him saying that, "I didn't receive my bread and my bread was taken from me." After investigation, it was found that he had taken the bread, and what he did was he threw the bread. He threw the bread that wasn't his initially. He gave it to the poor man. And so he died. The rahib died. When he died, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala resurrected him. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he weighed him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The 70 years in which he worshipped Allah to the 7 nights which he committed the zina, farajahat. The 7 nights of zina overcame his 70 years of worship. The 7 nights which he committed the zina with the woman, It overcame the 70 years of worship. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he took the bread which he gave, which he wanted and he needed. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, placed that on the scale, and his bread overcame the 7 nights of zina in which he committed. Sahih? So he became Ahlul Jannah just because of a bread. And this story, of course, the moral of the story is that, and as I said, it's narrated by Ibn Abi Shaybah in his Musannaf, and others have narrated it, but it's sahih, is that لا تحقرن من المعروف شيئا. Don't be, ever belittle a righteous action and think to yourself, oh, this is very little. A woman was a zaniya, she was a prostitute. She was a what? She was a prostitute. She was a prostitute. And what she did was, with the prostitution, she went down for water to drink. She took off her shoes. And guess what she saw? She saw a thirsty dog. And she fed that dog from her shoe. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala took her to Jannah because of a dog she fed. Never belittle a righteous action. But the reason why I brought all of those is because the truth of the matter is not how long you pray for. And if you fast at day and you pray at night, you come with these beautiful actions. The truth of the matter is the person who is the best is the one who has knowledge. And that's the ones Allah praised. These monks, they worshipped without knowledge. And this statement of the Shaykh, كُلُّ مَنْ كَانَ أَعْظَمَ عِلْمًا, everyone who has more knowledge than you, بِذَلِكَ وَتَصْدِيقًا, and he believes it more than you, وَاعْتِرَافًا, acknowledges it more than you, وَعَمَلًا, an action more than you, كَانَ أَكْمَلَ إِيمَانًا, then that person is better than you in knowledge. We've come to a time where what? Where people will just look at a person's actions, and if his actions are good, even if he has no knowledge, they'll praise him for it. لذلك, that's very dangerous. They are two twins, knowledge and implementation. Both of them need one another. And that is, of course, what? Surah Al-Asr, right? When did Allah say, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Knowledge and right, al-Iman billahi tabarak wa ta'ala, which is to believe in Allah. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, you can't believe in what you don't know. وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and righteous actions. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ, who come with da'wah ila Allah and come with patience. ولذلك الإمام البخاري رحمه الله بوّب بابا في كتاب كتاب العلم, he chapter a whole chapter كتاب العلم, what did he call it? باب العلم قبل القول والعمل. And he brought what دليل لقوله تعالى فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ فَعْلَمْ, know that there is none worthy of worship except Allah تبارك وتعالى, and ask forgiveness for your sin. فَبَدَأَ بِالْعِلْمِ قَبْلَ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ. Allah started with knowledge before action. ولذلك سفيان الثوري رحمه الله said, مَنْ ضَلَّ مِنْ عُبَّادِنَا those of our worshippers who go misguided, فَفِيهِ شَبَهٌ مِنَ النَّصَارَى, they have resemblance of the Christians. وَمَنْ ضَلَّ مِنْ عُلَمَائِنَا, and those scholars who become misguided, فَفِيهِ شَبَهٌ مِنَ الْيَهُودِ, there is a resemblance in the Jews. Because the Jews had knowledge, but they didn't have no implementation. The Christians had knowledge, they had implementation, no knowledge. The believer is distinct for what? To combine between knowledge and action, both of them simultaneously. Naam.
والإيمان بالملائكة والقدر داخل في هذا الأصل العظيم.
So again, believing in the angels and believing in the Qadr also enters this. Because why? Where would you find the Quran? If have you believed? So what did we just say right now? الإيمان بالكتب تابع للإيمان بالرسل, right? To believe in the books, you'd have to believe in the messenger, right? Are you with me? Also, can you believe in a messenger, or can you believe in a book without believing in an angel? Who is the one who sent the book down onto the Prophet? Angels, right? For example, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he sent to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also the prophets before, who did he send the revelation with to send it to the messengers? Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam. Also the Qadr, the predestiny, صح? You would find it also in the Quran. And that which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He destined, subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at the Quran today, the qada and the qadar is present in the Quran. So once you believe in the kutub, you would have to believe in the qada and the qadar, because it's present in the Quran. Naam. Of course, with the four pillars of the maratibuhu al-arba'a, with its four pillars, the qadar. Naam.
وَمِنْ تَمَامِ الْإِيمَانِ بِهِ أَنْ يُعْلَمَ أَنَّ
أَنْ يَعْلَمَ
أَنْ يَعْلَمَ أَنَّ مَا جَاءَ بِهِ حَقٌّ لَا يُمْكِنُ أَنْ يَكُومَ دَلِيلٌ عَقَلِيٌّ أَوْ حُسِّيٌّ عَلَى خِلَافِهِ.
The Shaykh رحمه الله here says, مِنْ تَمَامِ الْإِيمَانِ بِهِ, from the completeness of believing. مِنْ تَمَامِ الْإِيمَانِ بِهِ, from the complete things of believing in the Prophet is أن يعلم, to know أن ما جاء به حق, everything which he has come with is the truth. لا يمكن, it is impossible, أن يقوم دليل عقلي أو حسي على خلافه, that a rational or a empirical evidence can go opposite to him. There is, it's impossible that you can rationally prove something opposite to that which the Prophet stated, alayhi salatu wasalam. Or you can even empirically prove something opposite to what he established, alayhi salatu wasalam. It's impossible. Naam.
كَمَا لَا يَكُومُ دَلِيلٌ نَقْلِيٌ عَلَى خِلَافِهِ.
The same way is what? لَا يَكُومُ دَلِيلٌ نَقْلِيٌ, a textual evidences. Within the Qur'an, you can't prove that a hadith of the Prophet, which is sahih, sarih, goes against an ayah from the Qur'an. You won't be able to prove that. You can't. So you can't show dalilun aqliyun, or a dalilun hissiyun, or a dalilun naqliyun. Rational evidence, empirical evidence, a textual evidence that shows opposite to what the Prophet ﷺ affirmed. It's impossible. Naam.
فَالْأُمُورُ الْعَقَلِيَّةُ أَوِ الْحِسِّيَّةُ النَّافِعَةُ تجد دلالة الكتاب والسنة مثبتة لها حاثة على تعلمها وعملها.
If you look at, the Sheikh said, فالأمور العقلية, rational matters, or empirical evidences, both of them, تجد دلالة الكتاب والسنة, you will find that the Quran and the Sunnah actually indicated, and rather they affirm it. Anything that's rationally correct and it's empirically correct, you'll find that it won't, the Quran would actually have endorsed it one way or another. If it is rationally right, empirically right, you would find that the Quran and the Sunnah have actually what? مُثْبِتَةً لَهَا, has actually endorsed it and affirmed it before. حَاثَّةً عَلَىٰ تَعَلُّمِهَا, and rather has actually urged and advised on learning it وَعَمَلِهَا, to implement it. When the Muslims became weak and they stopped learning, studying the academic knowledge, you see, it's one of the things the Muslims have lost importance, and it's very important, la shakka wa la raib. We don't give it as much importance as it deserves. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, what did he say to us in the Quran? قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ بَدَأَ الْخَلْقِ. Look what this ayah is telling you. Go travel the earth and look how Allah created, how Allah started the creation of everything. You're actually told to examine everything. Allah is telling you, go out there and empirically and rationally try to reason with things around you. The Sharia has nothing to hide. Our Kitab and our Sunnah is not saying to you that that is devilish. Lidarika, Christianity and the church, when academic and science started to progress, the industrial age, this was something that the church was against. Laws and, you know, fatawat and verdicts would be passed. But the Sharia is not like that. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, the stimulation of the people's mind and working and thinking and observing and looking, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always tells us to do it. And what we know as a fact is that nothing empirically you can prove to me, or rationally you can prove to me, or even textually you can prove to me, that would go against my textual evidence, the Quran or the Sunnah. I have already probably even, our Quran is even either mentioned it min dalalati al-mantuqi or dalalati التضمني or التزام, one way or another. Maybe I haven't got to the way of understanding it, or I haven't found, you know, I haven't come across the thousands of works of the scholars that we have lost, that we haven't received, that are in there, that have stated this before. But the matter, the truth of the matter is, the manuscripts that are being published every now and then, books that are coming out into light that were never seen before, that are mu'allafat, nafi'a, mati'a, sahih? So even Islam, inshallah ta'ala, and the people's knowledge of Islam is just growing. It's growing. So we're coming across books that are stating kalam and statements of the ulama that are now being scientifically proven, because they extracted it from an ayah or a hadith. Naam. Lidhalika, the point of the matter is, and this is what many people don't understand, and this is something that, because they didn't understand it, it became a reasoning why they thought they can criticize the Quran and the Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah affirms issues and matters which are contemporary, that are going on. It doesn't talk about it except by the manner of what? عَلَى الْأُصُولِ وَالْكُلِّيَّاتِ. It's what you have to understand. The Quran dealt with these issues that now are being scientifically proven or whatnot in a usul and a kulliyah manner, in a very comprehensive manner. Our religion did not come tafri'an lil ajza, to go into details of every branches that will break out from it. You know why? Because that would go against what? Balagha, the eloquence that the Quran holds, and the bayan that's in the Quran. But the person, the more he studies the qawa'id and the usul al-kamilatu fil kitabi wa sunnah, you will find every ruling which you're looking for. The religion has explained it for you. The religion has proven it to you. Every single thing you need min umuri deen and umur ad-dunyawi, the Quran has mentioned and explained it to you. And it has taught you. Do you know why? Because if the Quran speaks about a particular issue that was at the time of the messenger, then it could happen that it could not be applied on the time that we're living at. But what it did was, it brought a principle that the one at the time of the Prophet and the one that's going to come, a principle that they can all fall under. So it can be befitted, the rulings of the Quran Sunnah can be befitting لِكُلِّ زَمَانٍ وَمَكَانٍ, every time and every place, and not specific to a time and a place. So anything you would need, siyasat, politics, whether you need iqtisad, you know, finance, whether you want to look into issues of al-akhlaq and thaqafa, you want to look at issues of heritage and issues of manners and etiquette, the Quran has answers for all of that. Any worldly issue that you're looking for and a religious issue that you're looking for, the Quran has mentioned it. But my beloved brothers, how would the Quran have mentioned, how would it have spoken about it? The Quran builds it upon عَلَى الْأُصُولِ وَالْكُلِّيَّاتِ, and it doesn't come لَمْ يَأْتِ تَفْرِيعًا لِلْأَجْزَى. The Quran and the Sunnah didn't come to name every single thing. Sahih? Sahih? لذلك Allah تبارك وتعالى expands on things, but He leaves it unrestricted. So many things can fall under it. So it's just not understood as that particular thing which He's addressing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. As when He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He spoke about the birds, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala spoke about the riding beast, and Allah says, وَيَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَى, Allah will create whatever He wills. Technologies and cars, it falls under that. He left it unrestricted, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when time goes on, it falls under there. He would destine and He would creed, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for other things to be created. That's where it falls under. But if He lists A, B, C, D, E, F, G, the Quran would just be it wouldn't be something that has the eloquency and the balagha in it that it has. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala knows best. This is where we stop, bi'idhnillah al-kareem. We'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala, and we will then go to the third asal. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.